it's David Yang, CEO of Fullstack Academy. And today I'd really like to answer a question that I hear a lot from students is, how does our curriculum change and how do we think about curriculum at Fullstack? Fullstack Academy was one of the first JavaScript-only bootcamps, a bootcamp that taught JavaScript on the front end, what people are seeing in the browser, on the server side, what we call the back end, and actually even on the in the database. So why do we teach Fullstack JavaScript? I have a longer video that talks about the various reasons, but I have a quick overview. One is that JavaScript's always been a language that web developers have to know. They have to know JavaScript because JavaScript is really the only game in town when it comes to what's going on in the browser, right? So if you want to deploy code that does anything in someone's browser, which is most web applications these days, you have to be doing JavaScript. Now, there's been tons of attempts to create transpile to JavaScript. Google has something called Google Closure, Google Java Web Toolkit. And you know, people have really been trying languages that compile to JavaScript for years, but over time, people have realized that you always feel like you're in a bizarre world. If you want to do JavaScript, if you want to integrate with the full component library of the JavaScript world, you have to eventually be writing JS. And in 2009, and really started taking off around 2012, 2013, there was a technology created called Node.js that really allowed JavaScript to run it on the server side as well. And it was a really interesting server-side language because it handled concurrency quite well and really solved the problem that a lot of sites were having now, is that how do we add real-time components to our front-end infrastructure. And around that time, there's also a database technology created called MongoDB that had really made it very easy to connect from Node.js to a database. You could store JSON objects, you could write queries in JavaScript syntax, and even the tool used to interact with MongoDB was also mostly using JavaScript syntax. So around 2012, 2013, really JavaScript came into its own as what we call like a full stack language, and the idea of a full stack web developer became possible. And if you want to hear more, check out my video on why Fullstack teaches Fullstack JavaScript. And really, pedagogically, it's just, pedagogically is when you think about teaching, when you think about student learning, it's just very nice to teach one language, right? Because web development, we're not just teaching software language programming, right? We're teaching software programming in the context of development on the web, right? So you have to both learn how to program and all the different ecosystems you need to interact with, right? How to connect to databases, how to generate HTML, how the HTML gets sent down to the browser, how the browser interacts, the document object model, how to move things around on the client side. Right? So you have to learn more than just JavaScript. You have to learn how JavaScript interacts with all these ecosystems, and it's nice that you only have to learn one language, and students get really good at that language. One thing I tell students and employers is that test that our students are very deep in JavaScript, because if they can get deep in one thing, they can get deep in something else, right? If you study a whole bunch of languages, you go to a bootcamp where maybe you're learning Python, JavaScript, Ruby on Rails, some Java, right? It's like you'll have a little a breadth, but you have very little depth in any one of them, right? It's in any kind of budgeting of time, it's just impossible to create that depth across all those stacks. And so I tell employers, test for depth and then trust for breadth, right? And with one language in 12 weeks, students can go really deep. So that's our philosophy around why we teach JavaScript. And then I'll tell you a little bit about the changes that have happened over the years. So when we first started the immersive, we chose Node.js, we chose Express.js, which is the tech server-side JavaScript framework, and we chose Angular. And I think Angular was actually the first popular client-side framework. It was in the second generation of frameworks, right? There was obviously things before that, things like Prototype, Dojo. But the reason that Angular became very popular is that I think it very much appealed to the people who came from the Ruby on Rails world, right? It had everything out of the box. It made a lot of all the pieces work together pretty well, and it solved most of the problems that people had with front-end development. Really, how do I connect the data that I have with updating things that our clients are seeing? So we started with Angular and with Angular 1, and it was a pretty good choice. A lot of companies hired for Angular 1. A lot of companies really said, we're going to develop our applications on the Angular technology stack. And even today, we still have companies that come to us and say, we have a big Angular 1.x application. Do you have people who know that? Unfortunately, I have to say no now, because around 2014, 2015, we switched to React. That was one of our first big changes. And it's definitely one of those things where it was the first time I understood the inertia of curriculum. And I think that one of the great things about boot camps is that we put in a lot of the hard work to change our curriculum to keep it up to date with the industry. And the thing that really excited us about changing to React is, one, we saw the industry was moving there. But two, it really is a much smaller and nicer framework for students to learn, right? I have the mentality of Angular is like a full, like a built-out Lego kit, whereas React is a lot of small bricks and you can kind of build things creatively, right? And I think it's much better as you're learning to get small components that you can learn to compose rather than a very complex thing you have to learn together, only fits together one way. So we really liked about React. It was a bridge for a lot of JavaScript programmers into this more functional way of thinking, right? A way to, you know, and now we have React in functional components in React. And React really kind of was that gateway drug to functional programming for a lot of programmers. And I think it was and our students really liked it because they got to use small components composed well. That was our first big change, and it was painful because we had to rewrite the entire curriculum. Me and a couple of our instructors spent a Christmas holiday really diving deep into React, working with people in industry, building out little test beds here and there until we got something that we really liked in our curriculum. And I really think the thing that we saw with Angular and React is that the React had a way of blending HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that broke a lot of the like tested ideas in software development. So one of those tested ideas is that we should separate the concerns, right? Use different technologies to solve different problems. And that separation oftentimes resulted in people thinking, I will have HTML to describe the structure of my documents, I'll have CSS to describe the style of my documents, and JavaScript to describe the interactivity of my documents. And what React said is that, and you know, that was a nice separation, right? Because you could give the CSS and HTML to your designers, you could give JavaScript to your programmers, and have them interact with the server side using that JavaScript code. What React said was that, you know, as we build more complex applications, we're going to have to rethink what really are the boundaries between code, right? Because this component that's doing a lot of server interactivity, it's interacting with the client, it's changing style based off different things that are happening, it's the boundary is not, you know, the person who's working on this component has to think about all those things to really be a valid, to really kind of create a valid component. And so React really just threw all those things in the same pile and said, our components are going to be a mixture of HTML, a mixture of JavaScript, and now increasingly a mixture of CSS and of the styling capabilities of HTML. And so really it was changing from, you know, let's think about HTML, CSS, and JavaScript as the boundaries to let's think about components and how components interact with each other as a boundary. And a component is really an amalgamation of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. The second big change that we made in our curriculum was switching from Mongo to Postgres. And, you know, it wasn't a necessary change. Mongo is something that is still very fun to use. It still solves problems in a very interesting way. And it still probably is easier to interact with JavaScript or with Node.js than Postgres, in the sense that the impedance is lower, right? You have a JavaScript object, very easy to get to JSON, very easy to store that JSON into a Mongo, you know, Mongo document store. The reality is that, one, Postgres added a lot of these Mongo features, so the ability to store JSON blobs, the ability to search inside JSON objects, and at the same time, it also brought in all the good SQL features that really most applications are still using, most companies still like. The idea of normalizing data, thinking about how data is structured, how it interacts, and the tools that SQL gives you versus the tools that Mongo gives you, it's a good exercise to be able to think that way. And we decided to switch back to both really expose students to that and just feedback that we're getting from our employers and our alumni that, you know, Postgres and SQL is still a very valuable tool to know in industry. And the final change I would say is that we're seeing a lot more CSS and JavaScript frameworks. And so for a long time, we used a technology called SAS. SAS was a SAS and SCSS, which was a CSS preprocessor. And again, this goes back to the idea that there is the separating CSS, React, and HTML. Now really we're seeing more the design, the styling being brought into the React components and having JavaScript own that. Now, whether or not this, you know, the switch to React, I think we're starting to see where this idea of having everything as React components, JavaScript owning the entire thing. We're starting to see a few places where that boundary is causing challenges for development teams, but it really has been something that started in 2015 and has just gotten stronger. And I think the React ecosystem is something that is, we oftentimes get questions, do you think about Vue? What about the new Angular technologies? The new Angular 1, 2, 7, Ember.js. There's a whole bunch of virtual DOM-based JavaScript frameworks. So React has really just, I would say, won the fight in, if you're going to build a front-end application heavily focused on interactivity, a single-page application, then really React is, you'd have to have very good reasons to not choose React in 2019. And finally, I want to talk a little bit about the context switching of other programming languages. I think we've actually tried a 12-week immersive where we incorporated Ruby on Rails and JavaScript. And I think there's still a lot of bootcamps out there that teach Ruby on Rails. It was one of the first dominant programming bootcamp coding languages. And to be honest, I came up in the Ruby on Rails world. I love working on Ruby for the years that I did. I think really it's just the context switch is very painful. And if you can imagine, Ruby and JavaScript are very different languages too. If you can imagine the idea that you'll spend 6 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks learning Ruby, you finally get comfortable in it, and all of a sudden your instructors are saying, you know what, now change how you think about a lot of these things as we get into React, as we move into JavaScript. And it's a painful transition. And I think oftentimes our students got confused. They were just getting comfortable with one thing to move to something else. So I still think it's worthwhile for bootcamp grads and bootcamp students to study other languages. I just don't think it's great to do that in an intensive, immersive experience where you're also learning a lot of ecosystem technology. Now, when I think about what is a framework, why do we make these changes? How do we think about these changes? And really, I think we also have two conflicting and two orthogonal ideas that are sometimes in conflict and sometimes really mesh very well. And one is that we want to keep in line with industry, right? I am under no illusion that we can push the industry. I'm not going to say that, if Fullstack adopts Vue.js, then the industry will. I think we're not there yet, but I definitely think we have to follow where the industry is going. And when the industry really kind of consolidated around React, it was very exciting for us to do that. Because I think I've always been excited about React as soon as I saw it, I think, when it first released, but we had to wait till the industry to get there before we felt comfortable saying, okay, now let's teach our students this technology, right? We don't want our students going out there. We don't want to teach technology just for its own sake. We want to teach things that will get students jobs. And the second thing is we want to be true to good ideas in software engineering and in software and in coding, right? And so I think when I think about things like React, being more functional, being more isolated, having nice component-based architecture, and really separating concerns well, right? Separating concerns by components, it's always appealing to us when we can make choices where we get to go down both roads, right? Where the industry is there, and also where we give students smaller and more composable building blocks where they can use their creativity to combine it and connect them. And really, those are the two things that we always think about when we say, should we introduce this new idea to our technology, to our technology stack? And the other thing students ask is, what do we think is coming up next? And what are the next things we'll integrate into our curriculum? When I think about that, I think the obvious thing to me right now is TypeScript. And the reason for TypeScript is that, well, one, just as a funny story, I interned at Microsoft back in 2000, and I sat down the hall from this gentleman named Anders Helsberg. And what was interesting is that people told me, you're in the presence of a legend. So when you walk down the hall, if you can peek in and see what he's working on the future. So even from a very young age, I've always been very impressed by this gentleman named Anders Helsberg at Microsoft, who happens to also be the author of TypeScript. And I think what Anders Helsberg saw and what he heard from Microsoft developer community is that, look, we have 100,000, 500,000, million line applications written in JavaScript. We just can't continue to build and scale these applications without more ways to structure and connect the thinking around the different parts of the code, right? So Anders Helsberg had this idea of, how do I take some of the capabilities of static typing languages where we can specify that, hey, this parameter is going to be an int, this parameter an integer, this parameter is going to be a string, and this function is going to return this, so if you call it, you should expect to get this thing. How can I take some of these benefits of static typing and make it work in an ecosystem that's already as vibrant, developed, and large as JavaScript? And out of that came TypeScript. I think that as companies build increasingly large JavaScript applications, they're going to have to find tools that help them, make sense of it all, and TypeScript is one of the best tools. There's also Flow, but in my mind, TypeScript has won, and it's won really across both the startup world, the enterprise world. The next technology that I'm really excited about is GraphQL. And I think GraphQL really does something similar, is that it says, you know, you have technology on the front end, technology on the back end, and they have to communicate. And that communication, you know, it always starts out very nice, but over time, it can get quite complicated. All these little edge cases of, you know what, I need to send back this piece of information, or I need to send you this piece of information, and you get all these special edge cases. And what GraphQL does is it says, let us create a structured way for the front end and the back end to communicate, and also for the back end to send back data that the front end, in the way the front end is really looking for it. So it's a technology, it's not, the adoption on GraphQL is a little bit more challenging than TypeScript. So we're not seeing it as quickly adopted by enterprise as TypeScript, but it's something that I think really helps students. It solves that problem of, or it meets our criteria of things that companies are adopting, and also things that help students think in a different way and in a better way of software engineering. All right, so that's how Fullstack thinks about curriculum. All right, thanks so much. If you're interested, of course, check out fullstackacademy.com and to learn more about how we do things.